met a young man last year in Illinois at a conference I spoke at. He was a registrant. He was compliant. He was doing pretty well. He had his church. He had a support group. Things were going okay. And then 2 years previously, they passed another law. They passed another rule. And all of a sudden, his church was in an area he wasn't allowed to go to anymore. And he didn't know what he was going to do. And folks rallied around him. And they came to where he could be. And he reached out to me. And I said to him, please, hang in there. We're all in this together. We really are. Hang in there. I'm hopeful. I wish he could be here this morning to see this group. I wish he could be here to feel this energy, because this does make me hopeful. I told that to Bill Dobbs yesterday. I am hopeful. Part of my presentation may not sound so hopeful, but I hope by the end it will actually feel hopeful. I appreciate Janice's shout out to the law school. I'm very proud of law school. When I called them up and I said, would you do this conference? Yes, of course. Would you do it for free? Yes, of course. Janice said, please tell them what the topic is. I said, I don't think it's going to matter to them. I called back and they said, of course you can hold it here. And so for our first inaugural to be in my home, away from home, is incredibly meaningful to me. I'm delighted to talk about this. Yesterday, Emily kicked it off so beautifully. We talked about the noise, how to cut through the noise. And so I want to talk about the legal way I think we can cut through the noise, to provide some of those tools, kind of that continuation of empowerment for all of us, on the tools to use from the legal side. Never mind that the laws don't work. They don't. Never mind that the cost of human life, the cost of finances, clearly outweighs any tiny, tiny benefit they have. It does. Never mind that. Never mind that they are purely immoral, which they are. How do we do this to other human beings? It is immoral. I just want to talk about it from the legal angle, and I guess being a law professor, that's a good place for me to begin. For the last 13 years, my scholarship has been devoted to the talk of sex offender registration laws. Starting really in 2004 when I stumbled upon it researching statutory rape. And since that time, it is something that's been a singular focus for me. At the time I started, I think I could count on one hand mature scholars that were talking about it. In 2003, 2004, there were not the conferences. People weren't discussing it. There were a few students talking about it. By and large, it was the butt of jokes. It was bad stuff, bad films. And I was pretty much alone out there. But I'm not alone anymore, and that contributes to the hope that today there's a lot of scholars out there. There are social scientists like Emily. There are scientists doing research. There are journalists talking about it. And there are legal academics writing about it, a lot of legal academics writing about it. The former dean of Mitchell Hamlin Law School, Eric Janis, has just written an incredibly powerful, a friend of the court brief on the civil commitment system. And he has written so beautifully. I never get phone calls. There's a couple of articles I want to point out. I put some free articles on the back table for you. One is my 2012 article published in Hastings Law Journal. It has been was 2 years in the making, and it really started to explore these incredibly piled-on registration schemes. And my argument, the United States Supreme Court decision of Smith v. Doe, was no longer good law. And I want to talk a little bit about that. I've been very pleased that that's been the subject of a number of appellate briefs, and two Supreme Courts have cited it, and the Doe v. Snyder Appellate Court recognized it. And the other one I want to give a shout out to is Emily and Larry's book. I wrote a book chapter in it called Caught in the Web, which, like publishers say, it was supposed to be out yesterday, so we're hoping the end of June it's going to be out. And at this time, I want to acknowledge a research assistant of mine, David Chanteau, if you just raise your hand. David is a current research assistant. We're working on two articles. One of the things that I do is I have research assistants, and about every 2-3 years, I give a speech to my students, because they go into the prosecutor's office. They are public defenders. They actually end up writing the laws, and all of them come back. All of them come back and say, this is wrong. David may have been the record pace. He started researching, and in 4 days, he comes back and he says, "This is outrageous. I am so angry. When can I help start writing it for you?" So I'm delighted that he is here with you. People ask me, how did I get started in this topic? And sometimes somebody, a family member, will come to me and they'll say to me, "Surely you have somebody on the registry. Surely you must have a loved one or a family member. The subtext is, otherwise why would you care about us? Otherwise why would you write about this?" The answer is I don't. I don't have a family member. I didn't have a family member who was ensnared in these laws. Others have, and from their pain and anguish have come tremendous fellowship, tremendous compelling works. But that wasn't me. For me, it's all about the inherent unfairness. For me, as an academic, I look at these laws, and from a purely objective standpoint, they are wrong. They are unconstitutional. So I, as an academic, say, I've got to give my voice to it. I've got to give my voice where people don't have a voice. I'm not a practicing lawyer, so I can't do what Janice is doing, but from my scholarship angle, I want to try to convince the courts. That's where I'm coming from. There are 861,000 people on the registry. It's sort of like the McDonald's flip the burger sign. 6 months ago it was 850,000, and now it's 861. When I talk to groups who don't know about the registry, I say the number 861,000. They have this idea of what the politicians have told them. The hate mongering, the violent, high profile cases that are in the news. They don't know who's really on the registry. This audience knows who's on the registry. This audience knows that the vast majority of people on the registry should never be on a registry, even if we should have a registry, which I don't think we should, but even if we should, they shouldn't be. The vast majority are nonviolent, they're non-reoffending. Of that 861, and the McDonald's burger sign keeps flipping, it is growing more and more with nonviolent, non-reoffending. That's part of the noise we have to cut through, the noise that we recognized yesterday. So I want to briefly spend just a few moments talking about who the faces are of the registry, who's on that registry. This audience knows the people. Maybe at max 10% are what we might qualify as dangerous, maybe. But the vast majority are filled with the people who are listed here. I want to start with those who engage in consensual sexual activity. In some states it's called statutory rape. In other states it's called statutory sexual seduction, statutory sexual assault. It's voluntary sexual activity, but with somebody who that state presumes can't consent because they're underage. 46 states make this a registrable offense. California actually does not between the ages of 14 and 18, but 46 states, it's the only good thing about the California law, 46 states do though. And they make the person register whether the person knew the person was underage or didn't know the person was underage. And the craziness about those laws is nobody can agree on what that age is. California is an outlier at 18 years old. Average age is 16 or 17. And a couple of states have sort of put in the same relationship, you can drive a tractor, you can have sex. And so at 14 is the age for consent. Okay. They can't agree on that, but 46 states can agree that you should be on the registry if you actually violate the rule. I want to talk about one young man. You might recognize the picture. I'm going to call him a poster child because sometimes you need a poster child to bring out the issue to the public. Zach Anderson is that poster child. He was 19 years old, living in Indiana, got online with a girl who was 17 living in Michigan. Sounds good, only 20 miles away. So they agreed online. He drives to Michigan to have sex with the 17-year-old girl. All good so far, because Michigan allows that kind of consensual sexual activity. Not so good. She wasn't 17. She was actually 14 years old. She had lied to him. He was charged and convicted of statutory rape. That's actually not the nightmare. He served a little bit of time. That's not the nightmare. The nightmare was that Zach Anderson, back in Indiana, faced sex offender registry for 25 years and 61 restrictions. They threw the book at him. What were the restrictions? 19 years old. He couldn't live at home because he has a 15-year-old brother. He couldn't own a smartphone. He couldn't go to a restaurant that served alcohol. He couldn't talk to anybody under the age of 17 except for his brother. On which planet do we do this to people? Our planet. That's what went to national attention. And so we are so indebted to the journalists who caught wind of that story, to the people and everybody who made a big deal about it, and then they changed it. And they only did it because of the voices, because Zach's parents started it on a Facebook. There is power in a movement. There is power in voices, and Zach represents that. They overturned that. He was sentenced to 2 years probation, and the restrictions were really relieved. Non-contact sex offenses. CP is probably one of the growing areas on the registry, people who view child pornography. It also includes sexting. They don't know what to do about the two 16-year-olds who are sending each other sexual pictures, and now they're going to be registrants for life. Urinating in public, it's not a joke, it's true. People are on the registry for that. Public indecency. Decades-old crimes, and we all know these stories. Some of you may be facing these stories. There are people who served their time years ago, get out of prison long before a registry takes place. Knock on the door, guess what, buddy? You've got to register now. I'll talk about something called retroactive application. You've got to register now. I want to talk about one painful case. It's winding its way through the courts of Alabama, and we're hopeful that it might be the poster child for getting to the Supreme Court. A man by the name of Mr. McGuire sexually assaulted his ex-girlfriend in the early 80s. He went to prison for it, got out in 85 or 86, and by all accounts led a really good life after that. Moved to Washington, D.C., was a hairstylist, was a musician. He was doing really well. D.C. didn't have a registry. He was fine. 2009, his lawyer brother calls him, just opened up his shop in Montgomery, Alabama, and he calls him and he says, Mom is really sick. Do you think you could do me a favor and move home, live in her house with her, because that would really be helpful to us? And Mr. McGuire says, not a problem. He and his wife pack up. They move down to Montgomery. You're going to know where this story is going. Day one, lawyer brother says, you know, we have these registration requirements in Alabama. Maybe you should just touch base with the police station in Montgomery. I don't know. I don't know what they're going to say, but maybe that's a wise thing to do. We know that was like such a not wise thing to do, right? He touched base with them. He had never been on a registry. Touched base with them. That day, he was made a tier three offender. He was made homeless by that experience. And Alabama has the most egregious laws in the country. 114 ways to violate. I dare anybody in this room, anybody really in the city, to be able to go 25 years without potentially violating one of these restrictions. 114 ways. He had to register twice a week, once for the sheriffs, once for the city. So it's winding its way through the courts. His driver's license is stamped. All because of something he did in 1981. All because of that. Those with developmental disabilities, we've already heard, and I know we're going to have a panel on this, how we deal with that is absolutely critical. They're very vulnerable to being targeted in this way. Those without sexual motivation, did you know that? That our laws have so ensnared the public, it's not just about sexual crimes. I didn't know that. If one commits a crime against an underage person, it could be a theft, it could be a burglary, a robbery, there are states that actually make you register as a sex offender. I feel compelled to embarrass the Georgia Supreme Court at this point. You know, I really do. The Georgia Supreme Court had a 19-year-old guy, a drug user, who robbed his 17-year-old drug dealer. Okay? He was convicted of robbery. He actually pled guilty to robbery. That didn't bother him. They put him on the sex offender registry because the 17-year-old drug dealer was a girl and underage. no sexual motivation whatsoever. The Georgia Supreme Court said, well, we get to protect the children in all ways possible. Not just this case, false imprisonment cases all over the country. David's been researching false imprisonment, and so many of the registry are filled with that. And last but not least are the children who commit sex offenses. I spent the last 3 years actually writing about this. This is an area we need a lot more discussion about. The adult registry is critical, but we cannot forget the kids. These are kids as young as 9 and 10 who are required to register, and some required to register for life. Surprising, right? When I talk about this, people have a natural facial tendency. The jaw drops open, and in the law, there's something called shock the conscience, and it shocks the conscience. I say, can you imagine if you were held accountable for something you did at 10 years old? You cheated on a test, and the big letter C is now attached to your name. In high school and in college, forget being an accountant, you can't. You stole a candy bar in the third grade, you're a thief, and you're a thief forever. For kids who have committed a sexual inappropriate activity, and there are scores of from innocent, innocuous, to some coercion, they are on the registry, many for life. There was a Court of Appeals justice who leaned over, I assume he leaned over, because how tall can an 11-year-old be, and said, I know it may seem harsh to put you on the registry for life, but we're here to protect our society. That can't be true. That can't be. That can't be. So where did all this noise come from? Why are we in such an ugly state of rhetoric, an ugly state of language? What's this noise look like? I know you've heard this expression, once a sex offender, always a sex offender, which is nonsense. I think it comes from, I call it the Dexter effect. I think it comes kind of Dexter, if you ever saw the show about a serial killer who started doing bad things when he was 2 or 3 years old. And there's some talk that little children pull off the wings of butterflies might actually end up as serial killers. I don't know if that's true. But they think it applies to people who have committed sex offense. It's not true at all. What's really going on, and what we really have to talk about and acknowledge, and I think Emily alluded to it, is we are in the middle, the throes of a societal panic. We are in the middle of a panic where the fear is wildly distorted, completely wrong directed. That's the noise. That's the noise we're trying to break through. A wonderful sociologist, historian Philip Jenkins has written about this called The Moral Panic and Failure to Launch. And he talks about hallmarks of a social panic. And I want you to listen to these three hallmarks and see if it resonates for you. A social panic is seen by, first of all, is there an official reaction that's completely out of proportion to the threat? Oh yeah, you better believe it. Being in public and you're on the registry for 25 years, the thought that people are jumping out of the bushes left and right and kidnapping and child rape, all of that official reaction, clearly beyond the threat. Second hallmark, do the legislators, politicians, judges, trial court judges, and police all talk in the same identical terms about the perceived threat? You better believe it. Frightening and high. The mantras that you've heard, the things that you've faced, that Janice hears all the time, the noise. Identical terms. And then finally, a media that fans the flames. That we're going to change, that we are in the process of changing. So every high-profile case, every time, even SVU, right? The Law and Order show, SVU, terrible in this regard, absolutely horrible in this regard. Gotta change that. So when Anat Rubin writes something, when the New Yorker magazine produces an article, when Bill Dobbs writes something, these are all breakthroughs for us, because that's what ends up changing the noise. And what is this noise? I told Ira Ellman he's a rock star, and I think he is a rock star, and I bowed him. Yes. It's funny, the rock stars that academics have. This is my rock star, and I'm proud of it. The risk of recidivism is frightening and high, and that's the term that's used, and has been used since the Megan Kanka case, Doe v. Courts. and that the United States Supreme Court blindly adopted. We call this a sticky message, frightening and high. And in advertising, it's a message that's easy, that's pithy, that's short. Janice was right. Lawyers sometimes talk in too many words. Those words stick in the brain. The problem is those words are wrong. Those words are not true. And the Ellmans wrote a phenomenal article, really accessible, really easy to read, that really says the emperor has no clothes, that really exposes that myth. So what is the myth? Recidivism rates are low. They are low. I know you know that, but I can't go without saying it. We have to all acknowledge it, we all have to nod. We know that they're low. They're not only are they not frightening and high, they're not even medium, they're nothing. They are far lower than burglars, far lower than embezzlers, far lower than thieves. They are low. And the child offenders, 1%. To have kind of this entire construct for nothing is really important. And it substantially reduces over time. Janice mentioned this yesterday, and we have to talk about that. To have lifetime registry when we know the numbers don't bear that out is really just about the noise, just about the hatred, just about the hate mongering. I've got a slide here that I hope you can see, but even if you can't see the words, I hope you can see the lines. It is a really wonderful, quick snapshot produced by Carl Hansen, a foremost empiricist, but so is Elizabeth Tornow, so is Michael Caldwell, all producing great studies on recidivism rates. So the top line is those who are deemed to be at high risk for reoffending, the middle line is medium, and the bottom line is low. And what you see is, no matter where everybody starts on this continuum, at the far, what's that corner for you? Left? Left, right, right. Some of you depends which side of the room we're on. Okay. At the far left or the far right, no matter where you start on the continuum, by year 16 and a half, everybody's in the same place. No greater offending than any other offender. Having a registry for life for people on 40, 50, 60 years, not only is it immoral, it makes no sense. It doesn't actually work, or it doesn't fit. So how do we cut through this noise? That's what I want to talk about next. I want to talk about the legal tools, about how to come at it from that perspective. Emily talked about the culture. How do we change the culture? And I hope the journalists will keep writing about it. Because I'm schooled in the law, I want to talk about the law. I want to talk about coming at it from the court side. Janice and everybody in the trenches is empowered to fight the lawsuits, go in and lobby with the legislators. I want to talk to the Supreme Courts. I want to argue to them, because to me, that's really the place I think we can make change. In 1954, when the US Supreme Court wrote Brown versus Board of Education, it didn't wait for the culture to desegregate. It didn't do that. It said, you're going to. We're going to make this change. And we need the highest courts to do that. I hope the culture changes, but I can't wait that long. I need the courts to make the changes. So this is what I want to do for the remainder part of that my time. I want to briefly walk through the Supreme Court decisions that really have framed our conversation, shaped so many lives. I want to tell you legally why I think SORNA is wrong, is punishment legally. And then I briefly want to talk about a wonderful, remarkable tentative victory in the Sixth Circuit, Doe v. Snyder, teeing it up for Professor Ellman, who will continue that discussion later in the afternoon. 2003 is a watershed year for all of us. Two Supreme Court decisions came out in that year. You may not know the names of them, but you have felt their impact. The first case is called Smith v. Doe. Smith v. Doe involved an Alaska registry, and that's going to be important later for our talk. An Alaskan registry, early incarnation of the registry, 1994 registry. But the case comes in 2003 to the Supreme Court. So Alaskans said, you know what, I served my time. 1991, I got out of prison. Why dare you knock on the door and say I have to register as a sex offender? That's wrong. That violates basic rules. The rule it violates is what we call ex post facto. You can't be changing the rules midstream. You can't be all of a sudden saying that I had to serve my time and now you're adding something else. This is punishment. You can't do it. Could you imagine a football game where it's a 100-yard field? Oh, you're getting too close to the end zone. We're going to make it 120. We'd never do that. Never do that, Megan. The court said, this is a fabulous argument. The only problem is, it's not punishment. This is just a civil regulation. If it were punishment, we'd really take your argument. But it's not punishment. It's no different than the requirements for getting a driver's license. Really? The same time, only a few pages later, in the same book, comes out Connecticut Department of Public Safety versus Doe. There, Connecticut dumped everybody onto an internet registry. The internet was brand new, it was 1999. The internet highway, it's vibrant. Nobody knew the impact. Dumped everybody on the registry. And people started to say, wait a second, you should put me on a public registry. You haven't figured out if I'm dangerous yet. I'm not dangerous. Go give me a hearing and I'll tell you I'm not dangerous and you'll take my name off the registry. That feels like a really pretty good argument to make. The United States Supreme Court, just a crazy argument, said, you know what, they don't have to do that because they're just doing the fact of a conviction. If you'd gone down to the public records office, they'd be able to look up your conviction. So they're just dumping all the convictions in an internet registry. That's all they're doing. And they're going to put a little disclaimer that says it doesn't mean you're dangerous. Right. 1-2 punch. 2003. So look at the effect. This is a green light. This is a dog whistle. What it said to the states is, go at it. You can make laws as harsh as you want. It doesn't matter because they're not punishment. You can put everybody on the registry. It doesn't matter. It's not punishment. And guess what? They rose or went below that challenge in what I describe as a race to the harshest. States started to outdo themselves in making harsher and harsher laws. They couldn't fix our schools, they can't fix the roads, but man, they're putting in more amendments and more amendments. Look at what SORNA 2006 created. I told you it doesn't sound hopeful, but it's gonna get hopeful. So we expanded registrable sex offenses. In 1994, there were an average of 8 registrable offenses. Want to take a guess at how many now? 45. 45 nationally. States have been adding crimes to the registry. The first were 8 and not anymore. 45. Not only that, but you went to bed as a tier 1 offender and you wake up the next morning as a tier 2 offender. How did that happen, you say? Well, the Attorney General yesterday decided you were more dangerous. But I don't get a hearing. No, you don't have to have a hearing. We've just made you a tier 2 offender. Longer periods of duration, and more burdensome registration. I love that word registration. I've told groups before I'm Canadian, and in the old days, I used to have to file a postcard. That was called registration. You registered as an alien. You dropped the postcard into the box. It's not what registration is now. It doesn't look like that. It's too benign a term for all the burdens that go on. Told you that it applies retroactively? It does. You can wake up one morning to a knock on the door, and all of a sudden you're now on the registry, or now you're on the registry for a longer period of time. And the others I've mentioned subjects children to adult registration. It broadens the registry to include non-sexual crimes. And the last one for me is the worst. It imposes registration just on a conviction. No thought behind assessment. No thought behind change in assessment, no thought behind redemption. That was the conviction, it sticks with you forever. It's what I call super registration schemes. That's also a sticky message, and I'm pleased to report that courts have picked that up. Doe v. Snyder, the Sixth Circuit, mentioned it in its oral argument, because these are super registration schemes. They're schemes on steroids, and they are really inherently wrong. So, how do we make the change? I want to start by the idea that Smith v. Doe should no longer apply. That's our US Supreme Court decision that said there's no punishment. It doesn't apply anymore. Now, this is tricky, and I know Professor Ellman's going to go through that. it's hard to overturn U.S. Supreme Court stare decisis. First of all, nobody wants to make changes. Even in our own lives, we don't want to do that. A court doesn't want to do that. You have to show them why change is relevant. We've had five state Supreme Courts who've said Smith v. Doe is bad law. Yeah, but they did it a little bit, I won't say chicken because I'm glad they did it. They did it based upon their own state laws because they didn't want to tackle the U.S. Supreme Court. They didn't want to say, oh, U.S. Supreme Court's wrong. So they said, you know what, based on our laws, we think it's punishment. So I want to give you first the non-legal reason why it's punishment, and then I want to give you the legal reason. Here's the non-legal reason. If it walks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's a duck. Stop telling me it's not a duck. Stop telling me that sex offender registration laws are civil regulations. Stop telling me they're not punishment. Stop telling me they're not stigmatizing. Stop telling me they don't defame and isolate and ostracize people. Stop telling me they're the same thing as getting driver's license. They're not. It's not. It's punishment, pure and simple. It's like the sentence. Here's the good news. If we call it punishment, all the constitutional protections apply. So that's kind of, for me, there's other ways to look at it. That's, for me, one of the first goals we want to do. So now I'm going to roll up my sleeve, play magician, and tell you why I think Smith v. Doe doesn't apply anymore. I got two columns. Right side, left side, I don't know which side of the audience you're on, but one side is U.S. Supreme Court's view. They're looking at the 1994 registration scheme in Alaska. I want you to imagine yourself back to 1994. The registration scheme, 8 registrable offenses, no residency restrictions. Everybody could go wherever they wanted to. There was no internet. In fact, how could you find out about somebody on the registry even for notification? Was based upon going to the police station, just looking it up. You had to stay in the police station, look it up. So, the Supreme Court said in 2003, I don't know what you're complaining about. You don't have any affirmative restraint, that's a legal term. You get to move and live and be wherever you want in Alaska. Okay, that's not true now. Now we've got really serious banishment. We have basic constructive banishment through many parts of our country. Places where people can't live, can't work, can't travel. Complete loss of freedom of movement. Janice mentioned about the park. Can't go to parks. Maybe I can go to parks. I can't go over here to the movie theater. I can't be at a bus stop. Complete banishment and severe employment opportunities limited. Look at the difference between the two. Let's add another one. Supreme Court said, this is limited in scope. There's no in-person registration. In 1994, you popped the postcard in the mailbox. You didn't have to show up at the police station at all. And now, everybody is registering. Many more burdensome things. In-person registration, increased frequency. People are at the police station, not for 5 minutes. Hi, how are you? I'm here. Hours. Hours at their own cost. Hours without pay. Hours away from a job if they're employed. Not only that, but when they're in the police station, how are they treated? Horribly. Terribly, the frequency of the in-person registration. Look at how different that is. Feel the punishment piling on? This is so different from what Smith v. Doe looked like. The Supreme Court said, there's no shame or humiliation. I know. It's a conviction. You were convicted. That's all it is. That's all that this internet is doing, is just stating the conviction. It's not like the stockades from the colonial times. And the court talked about that. Now, if you were like the stockades from the colonial times, we might take interest. Guess what? We are like the stockades from the colonial times. Guess what? You said in 2003 if it was like that, you'd reconsider? That's where we are right now. The internet registry follows us everywhere. It's like ghost prints. There's some wonderful articles actually moving around that say that back in 2003, with the internet just having developed, the court was naive about what the internet's impact would be. The court maybe didn't understand, but we are comfortable, not confident, that actually the court today understands the impact of the internet. You can't get off of it even if you get off the registry. That internet follows you everywhere. There are trails that follow you no matter what. And then they said registration is not akin to supervised release. It's really not like a sentence, not like punishment. Really? Really? Mandatory conditions? 114 in Alabama, where if you fail one, you go to prison for 10 years? This is why it's punishment, and this is why I believe the court is going to take note. So I have hope. I have hope. And I want to talk briefly about Doe v. Snyder. Federal court decision that came down that said you're right. You're absolutely right. The Michigan laws are really horrible. The 2006 to 2011 amendments are so extreme, they are super registration schemes, and you've got to rewind them. They finally said it's a duck. They finally said it's punishment. And because it's punishment, ex post facto is going to apply. And just briefly, I want to talk about a couple of things that they said, because I know that Ira's going to talk more about it. They said when you created these school restriction zones, you actually, in effect, created near banishment, because there's a school everywhere. Can't work, live, and look at the word loiter. I don't even know what that word means. You can't work, live, or loiter in a school restricted zone. They said the burden on the registrant is substantial, and I want to read this quote from the court. Because the state walked in and said, this is just minor. That's the noise, that's their mantra. It's just minor. It's just like a driver's license. It's no big deal, no big deal. And they said, surely, something is not minor in indirect just because no one is actually being lugged off in cold irons bound. It is substantial. The state, they're so pompous. They have the frightening and high behind them. They got the Supreme Court behind them. They got the states behind them. They think they have the public behind them. They came into the Sixth Circuit completely unprepared, and I'm happy to say that out loud. They didn't come in with evidence. The defense came in with evidence. Miriam Ackerman of the ACLU and Paul Reingold of the Michigan Law Clinic were incredible. They had the evidence. See, they cut through the noise. The state walked in and said, we're the state. We don't have to have evidence. Just listen to us. It's frightening and high. They were surveyed at high rates. You've got to believe us. And the Sixth Circuit said to them, you didn't produce any evidence to meet your burden. Shame on you for coming in and not producing any evidence. And look at the last line. They rejected the dog whistle. They said, just because Smith v. Doe is out there, don't be thinking it gives you a blank check to produce all the amendments, everything you want to do. Don't be doing that. That's such important words, because it comes from a federal court tackling Smith v. Doe. It's important words, as was mentioned yesterday, because it came from one of the most conservative justices around the country. And it's important words because it recognizes all of our reality. We already knew all of this, and now to have a court actually acknowledge this is not the end. Doe v. Snyder is going to go up to the Supreme Court, other stuff's going to happen, but this is hope. We've cracked an important kind of ceiling, or floor, however you want to look at it. I want to finish with something about movements. Because in 13 years of working on this effort, I've seen growth. It's not fast enough, and it's certainly not fast enough for those living with it, but I've seen growth. And this short video really reminds me what the creation of a movement looks and feels like. I think the sound is good. I hope you can see it, and I know you're going to smile.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. So it takes guts to be the first follower. You stand out and create ridicule for yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. A first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Tree is a crown, and a crown is a movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers get the followers, not the leaders. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement that you really care is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
Questions if you have any. I'm happy to take a few. I think we have a couple of minutes before we have the break.
Jay. So, and I don't know if Ira's going to focus on this. It feels so hopeful to see you go through this. And then the
part. I think I'm lying.
You know, and then to follow the sort of the, like the train of noise that goes with newscasts, right? Another part of my brain thinks about the personalities that are on the court. And then I go to actually a place of how is this going to ever get through. How do you hold those?
So the question is sort of that tension between the hope. I'm repeating the question for the camera. But the tension between the hope and what may feel like the reality of the situation. Moves happen incrementally. This is the long haul of a struggle. That again is part of the conversation that Bill and I had yesterday. If one wants to think about from here to there, which I understand, especially if one's in the situation, it feels daunting and frustrating. But if one can think about this incrementally, progress and what progress looks like, and we can hold on to that progress, it may be two steps forward and one step backward. But I can tell you that just looking at it from its abyss, in 2007, 2008, we've already made progress at the court level, is where I want to talk about. And only a few big swings, but it's starting to happen. So that's what I'm focusing on, because you're absolutely right. The cultural noise is deafening, and we have to keep that out, otherwise it can feel quite hopeless.
Gannis spoke about briefly yesterday, and you spoke about it again today. Sometimes there's a word that's badly abused, it's called recidivism. In the closing argument in the case, a prosecutor will say, well, we have to keep an eye on people because of recidivism rates of crime. That suggests that they're reoffending, and they're not. It just means that they're likely to be reincarcerated. So I want to thank Gannis yesterday for like explaining the difference on that. And I ask you, like, that's one of the words we have to tell people, hey, that's not true.
Yeah.
We are not recidivating. We're not reoffending.
I think one of the key questions about recidivating or recidivism or reoffending, and the Ellman's article really goes through that beautifully, is who knows even what that word means, and everybody's using it differently. Are you talking about an actual sexual crime?
Yeah.
Are you including in the failure to meet your requirements? So if you include non-compliance, then all of a sudden it grows, but that's not really a new sexual crime. That was the failure to register or the failure to discuss your travel. Then if you add in different kind of reoffending, And depending upon the person's agenda, everybody's using different numbers. This is why the social scientists and our empiricists are so important. To the extent that they're objective, Elizabeth Letourneau, Carl Hansen, to the extent that they are not fueling some cottage industry or making a lot of money off of it, those numbers. But how we define it, you're absolutely right, how we define it is really a critical narrative in the story. Vicki, you have a question?
In the Dobie Snyder, I know that the stores ask the Solicitor General, I think, and I was told it was like they had 30 days to answer. I haven't heard anything further about their answer.
So Vicki has asked the question about Dobie Snyder and asked about the next step with the United States Supreme Court. So I'm going to play like that newscaster, film at 11. Ira's going to talk about that at 1 o'clock. Unless you want to, did you want to talk about that now or at 1 o'clock?
No, well, I'll wait for the tension.
Okay.
Thank you, Rachel. What was the source of the slide that you showed?
The Carl Hansen slide?
The recidivism.
Yeah, let me pull it back up. It's actually available online.
Online where?
Yeah, hold on. I'm going to find the slide and then I can be able to tell it to you. Let me go to 17.
Legislators are always asking for that.
I actually know where that is.
Janice, will you post it on the, maybe on the website?
This is the California Sex Offender Management Board issued a report in April 2014. This is in their appendix, I think it's B as in divine, and page 16. So, not that I've ever looked at it before, but yeah, we send this to the press, we send this to legislators all the time. This is a really, really important chart. And again, you know, this sometimes we in fact refer this to as the redemption line, right? Mm-hmm. When is somebody redeemed? And Carl Hansen is the world's expert in this, folks. So nobody can question Carl Hansen's credentials when it comes to this. This is like this. Captain was saying, how do we cut through the noise? We bring the facts to them. And I will tell you, it doesn't always meet with welcome ears. I remember taking the facts to Melendez, Senator Melendez's office in the state capitol, and it was about the California Department of Corrections, and they put out a report that said the rate of reoffense for somebody on parole was less than 1%. And her chief of staff told me, you're lying. Now, we printed a copy of that report for her, the front, the title page, and one page. And I said, we're not going to print 100 more pages for you, but it's available on the internet. This is also available on the internet. So look under California Sex Offender Management Board. There's an April 2014 report, and I believe it's called Tiered Registry. And honest to God, I believe it's on page 16.
Yeah, I think you're right. So that's also progress that it made its way into the report by the management board in 2014, where that never would have happened before.
April 2014, I know the case on the website, it's very hard to find.
Yeah, it is very hard to find.
No. Just type casomb.gov. No. And then, or .org, neither one will work. They're actually governmental. And then there's some links on the top. One of them is reports. Click on reports. And look under 2014, or done by year, and it'll be right there.
And you know what I'm also going to do, because this is my law school? I'm going to print out copies of the slide, and I'll have them in the back as well. Yes. There is an advantage to being at home. Okay, I can do that. Any other questions? Sir?
In terms of sort of the absurdity of lifetime registration for childhood offenders, I was wondering about the possibility of linking this with some of the U.S. Supreme Court cases on the life term punishment, because they've clearly shown that that's not doable. So.
That is, the question is, the United States Supreme Court held that a lifetime sentence for a juvenile was unconstitutional. So robbery, aggravated robbery, even murder, you couldn't sentence them to lifetime without the possibility of parole. They needed rehabilitation. And so I thank you for teeing up that question, because that actually was the heart of my 2013 article. I think it's absolutely true that lifetime registration is akin to lifetime without the possibility of parole. That two 14-year-old boys did something really stupid in New Jersey a couple of years ago. They pulled down their own pants and sat on the faces of two 12-year-old boys. It was a brutal sexual prank. It was stupid. And they were charged and convicted and forced to register as sexually violent predators for the rest of their lives. And so I stumbled on that case to end up arguing exactly, sir, what you've just... What is your name?
Dan
Freeman. Oh, sir. I didn't need to ask. Okay. Sorry. I just like to know people. I apologize. I hadn't mentioned before. That is exactly the same thing, that you could sentence somebody to prison for life without the possibility of parole is unconstitutional, but in the same breath, you could make them register as sex offenders for life. So we are hoping that's going to make its way to the courts. We'll keep fingers crossed about that. I'm not asking any of this. I don't have time.
Well, actually, you know what I'd like to do, Catherine, if you don't mind? I would like to invite some of our people here, anybody who wouldn't mind being videotaped, to come up and talk about your experience at the conference thus far. We actually want to present, to make a video for next year, because we will have a conference next year. Maybe some of you who might have had a positive experience can come up here, and again, you don't mind being videotaped, because that's what the purpose of this is. Is there anybody in the audience that would be willing to do that?
What would you like us to say for the
With that note, I'm going to say thank you very much, everybody.